Very warm welcome, everybody, to what is our fourth, I think, open service. Tonight's topic is What is Heaven Like? I think it's our most challenging subject so far, and it'll be interesting to see how enlightened we feel at the end. But shall we just start with a prayer? Guide us, loving Father, as we explore this topic of heaven. May we be excited at the thought of heaven. May we be encouraged by the faithful lives of believers that have gone before us. And may we, like them, at the end of our lives, be welcomed into heaven by our loving Saviour, your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
So thank you, Miller, for that introduction and welcome. As Miller said there, this topic has been something of a challenge for us as we've looked for material and thought around it. And I think there's several reasons for that. The first reason being that heaven actually is a mystery. It's something beyond our comprehension. And we can only kind of grasp small parts of it and have small insights into it. So that's okay. But there's another reason, perhaps that's slightly more worrying, in that I think we've lost our desire for heaven in some senses. When you go back to the medieval world, if you've ever been into any of those big cathedrals with pictures of heaven, it was a reality to those people, very much so. Whereas perhaps to us nowadays, we've lost something of that urgency, that vision, that sense of heaven being something to look forward to. And that's perhaps because we've fooled ourselves into thinking that we have heaven now. You know, we have so much, and life on the whole can be so comfortable that we have just forgotten about heaven. When we talk about heaven, as we go through this service, there's three aspects that I just want to lay before you that are very much tied up in the picture of heaven. The first one is Jesus, and Scripture often talks about the kingdom of God. That's not the heaven we are kind of thinking about tonight. The kingdom of God is what we as Christians are called to build here on earth. It's something in which the values and the reality of heaven are built here, now, in our time. And that's important because heaven is not just pie in the sky when we die. Heaven is something we need to be about now, making something of the truth and reality of it present here on earth. So that's things about peace and justice and kindness and equality and all those kind of things. The heaven we're talking about has two aspects to it, I guess. There's the heaven now, so where God exists, where we go to when we die, that sense of heaven that is present, is a reality now. It might be a reality, something slightly beyond our imagination, but it's there, it's where God is. And then there is also the heaven yet to come, because Scripture tells us that there will be a new heaven and a new earth when heaven and earth will be reunited as they always should be, when earth will be with heaven as it always should have been. So there's those two aspects we'll be grappling with as well tonight. So a lot going on. But before I ramble on any further, we go to our first song, which captures something of heaven, really, something to look forward to be excited about. And it's called Because of You, There's a Place.
There's a place where the streets shine with the glory of the Lamb. There's a way we can go there, we can live there, be on time because of you. Because of you. Because of your love. Because because of your blood. No more pain, no more sadness, no more suffering, no more tears, no more sin, no more sickness, no injustice, no more death because of you. Because of you. Because of your love. Because of your blood. All our sins are washed away.
Yes, Lord.
And we can live forever. Now we have this hope because of you. We'll see you face to face. And we will dance together in the city of Abba because of you. There'll be joy everlasting. There'll be gladness. There'll be peace. There'll be wine ever flowing. There's a wedding. There's a feast because of you. Because of you. Because of your love. Because of your blood. All our sins are washed away,
everyone.
And we can live forever. And now we have this hope because of you. We'll see you face to face. And we will dance together in the city of our God because of you.
Yes, Lord.
Because of you. Because of you. Because of your love. Because of your blood. All our sins are washed away.
Thank you, Lord.
We can live forever. Now we have this hope because of you. We'll see you face to face. We will dance together in the city of Abba because of you.
Good evening, everyone. As the planning team, we realised that none of us really knew what heaven would look like, and that a lot of our pictures were actually came from pictures that we had seen perhaps when we were growing up. If we could have the first slide, Jeremy.
chapter 21, verses 1 to 5, a new heaven and a new earth. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Then there was no longer
and a new earth. For the first heaven,
I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them, saying, they will be his people, God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.
Evening, Paul. Turned out nice again. How are you?
Evening, Simon. Hi. Turned out nice again. I'm okay. Apart from my dodgy back is giving me a bit of jip. Hey, it's your 100th birthday tomorrow, isn't it? What are you looking forward to?
Well, I'm really, really looking forward to my telegram from the Queen.
Ah, the good old Queen. She must be 168 years old by now, isn't she? Still doing a good job, though.
And I've started to look forward to heaven.
Heaven. Yeah, I guess that's a good thing to think about whilst you still can. All those streets paved with gold. I wonder if there'll be bike racks in those streets like there are in Brockenhurst. Or will there even be bikes?
I'll tell you what I'm not looking forward to. All those boring sermons. Some of them on earth feel like they go on for eternity. And that's even when I'm giving them.
Yeah, and up there they actually will.
And some of those modern songs we sing on Sundays, even down here, they just seem to repeat the same lines over and over and over and over again. Imagine doing that forever.
And how will they keep those harps in tune? There's nothing worse than an out-of-tune harp.
And being stuck in the same place day after day.
Yeah, I mean, it's been bad enough in COVID lockdown. Imagine lockdown forever.
What are we going to do to keep busy?
Well, apparently those that please God on earth will be ruling with him in heaven.
I really hope not. I've had enough committee meetings here on earth to last a lifetime, let alone an eternity.
Oh, well, I'm sure there'll be football to watch each weekend. Imagine all those people singing You'll Never Walk Alone. It'll be almost as good as the Cop in Anfield.
Well, there certainly won't be any sailing in heaven.
What?
Yeah, doesn't the Bible say something about there being no sea in heaven anymore? And I wonder if you will ever even have the chance to be alone. All those people milling about.
Oh, it's supposed to be peaceful. I can't see how it will be with all those people making a noise.
Imagine the queue at the bar on a Saturday night.
Oh, I guess there's a lot we can't really understand about heaven.
Ah, well, even though there's so much we don't know, it's nice to think about all the good things the Bible tells us about, especially the wedding feast. I'm really looking forward to that.
Aye. And those new bodies were promised, so I can get my dodgy back fixed.
So, you've had some of our pictures of heaven, both those that are out there in the media, as it were, and some of our thoughts about what we might not be looking forward to so much about heaven. What do you think heaven is like? That's the question now for you to discuss in your groups for 7 or 8 minutes. What's your picture of heaven? There we go. Hello everyone, welcome back. I hope you had really good discussions about heaven, maybe even had a glimpse of it. So feedback from the groups. Who shall we start with? Miller's group. Miller, what did your group discuss?
We had a great discussion actually. We talked about people who had near-death experiences and how there was this sort of people seem to have had amazing experiences of light and of seeing people that they recognise. So that was good. But that then brought on a discussion about the fact that the Bible actually talks about the fact that we won't go straight to heaven, that we're all going to go together. So we got a little bit confused there. And we had a short chat about something a bit purgatory-like or paradise-like in between. Then we talked about how, whether it was a sign of being a very mature, good Christian, if you were really looking forward to going to heaven, or whether it was a sign of not being very secure in your faith, if you're actually quite keen to keep on living. I think the conclusion we came to on that one, that, God has created us with a real desire to live until things become quite untenable, and then we long for heaven. We had a very good discussion.
Thank you. Brilliant. Mike, your group? There he is.
Yep, we had a wide-ranging discussion about heaven and the difficulty of visualizing it. Will it be all light? Will there be any night? Will we get rest? Will we do the same sort of things? Will it be like Earth, only a better place without the evil and the sadness and the sin, and therefore just a much better version of what we already enjoy here? Or will it be something completely different that we can't conceptualize? So plenty of questions, and of course no definitive answers. All I think Phil thinks we probably did actually solve the question, and then heaven being outside of space and time, back to the whole living in the present and what we thought about living in the present versus an eternal aspect, which is part of how we perceive time as we are now. So we had a good chat.
Thank you, Mike. And that leaves Sue and her group. Come in, Sue.
I'm here. I couldn't see myself as being spotlighted. Here we go. Our group again had good discussion. I think we all agreed that we didn't know what heaven looked like. I think at least one member in our group finds it very difficult to believe in heaven, and I think that's because of this difficulty of visualising and thinking. Perhaps in the older days it was almost something made up to keep people happy. I think there were also lovely pictures of it being a garden, of it being a mansion, streams running through it, even if we haven't got any sea. There was a definite vote that there should be no more meal planning required in heaven, that it would. There was a picture of a wedding feast, was a nice one. I like the image of walking with God. I mean, as somebody who's keen Walker, I thought somebody suggested that, and I think that's a lovely idea. Heaven will be a very spacious place. And then right at the end, I thought some real wisdom that someone said that the thing about heaven is it has to be at the heart of Christianity, because without resurrection, there is no hope. And if there is resurrection, there has to be a place to enjoy that resurrection.
Thank you, Sue. Those sounds like some very interesting conversations and great ideas. So I've got some highlights here of what we do know about heaven from Scripture. Just some sort of wide-ranging thoughts, really. I mean, during our present age, heaven is the place where God dwells. Jesus talks about heaven, and one of the things he says about heaven is our Father in heaven. So the theology books define heaven as the place where God most fully makes known his presence. It's where God most fully is at this present moment. We know that Jesus ascended in his physical resurrected body into heaven. We know that Stephen saw it opened when he was being stoned, when he was being executed. We know that Paul had a vision of heaven. He talks about someone who people believe he was speaking about himself, had a vision of the three levels of heaven, and it was a vision that motivated him and his missional activities for the rest of his life. So it was a powerful thing for Paul, that glimpse of heaven. Jesus tells us, doesn't he, in John's Gospel, I think Sue referred to it, that he goes to prepare a place for us in heaven. When he talks of that place of many rooms, heaven being a place of many mansions. Heaven is a place that exists now, but is beyond our natural senses. Its exact location is unknown, but it's the place in which God dwells. So what is heaven like now, this heaven that we don't quite know where it is or what it is? Well, when we look at the language used in the Bible, we know we're given a picture of heaven being like a garden. Jesus, dying on the cross, says to the thief next to him, "Today, I tell you, you will be with me in paradise." And the word, the translation of the word used for paradise, means a beautiful garden. And actually, it's the reason why at the heart of a cloister, so if you go to a monastery or a cathedral with a cloister, there's just a green garden that is actually, it is called paradise, and it is supposed to be a place of beauty and of peace. That's why that's there. It's a picture of heaven to that community. A picture of a garden, a beautiful one. Book of Revelation gives us a picture of heaven as a city in which God is so present that there's no lights required because he is the light of that place. It's, as we heard from Joyce, from the reading from the Book of Revelation, that it's a place in which there's no suffering or crying or pain. And when in the sketch, when we referred to heaven as being a place where there is no sea, that's because to the Jewish people, sea was a place of chaos. It was a place where monsters dwelt, a place to be avoided. And that's why it refers to heaven as being a place with no sea, because it's a place, the opposite of that. It's not a place of chaos. It's a place of safety, a place of peace. So if you are sailors, don't worry. There still may be sailing in heaven, okay? It doesn't mean to say there's no water or no sea. It just means there's no chaos. So maybe it's perfect sailing, no storms. How marvellous. What will heaven be like? That's that context of actually there is a heaven now, but there is still a heaven yet to come. Because as the book of Revelation tells us, there will be a new heaven and a new earth. Both will be joined and will be as they were supposed to be. So that's almost like the picture in the book of Genesis, isn't it? When God is with his people, Adam and Eve, in the garden. They are together and everything is as it should be until sin entered into the equation. Well, that's what heaven will be eventually, heaven and earth united together as they were always meant to be. We're told, Jesus tells us that in heaven there is no marriage, many people have speculated why that is, but I think it's probably something to do with the fact that as human beings we are limited in our capacity to love, not just by sin, which ultimately what sin is all about, our failure to love as we should. Ourselves, other people, God. And that really is sin. We just don't love as we should. We are limited in our ability to love. And marriage is an exclusive relationship in which we love most fully, where we are most able to love because of our limitations. Well, actually, in heaven, if we can fully love, we don't need marriage anymore, because we can love fully everyone as they should be loved, like God loves. So why would you need marriage? I think it's connected with that idea of our capacity to love. Heaven is a place just of love, which is something to look forward to. We're told it's like a marriage feast. So the picture of that is heaven is not boring. Heaven is a place of joy, of celebration, of food, of wine, of good things, something to really look forward to. And we are told that ultimately we will have a resurrected body, as Jesus had a resurrected body. And there's lots wrapped up in that, really. When you think about Jesus walking on the road to Emmaus with the two disciples, those disciples didn't recognize Jesus, did they, when they walked with him? And yet when he broke bread, they did. So in terms of Jesus's resurrected body, there was something familiar about it, but something new about it, something different. It could pass through solid walls. He appeared in the upper room with the disciples. So that speaks to me of if you die at the age of 100 with a body that's racked by arthritis, you're not going to have a body like that for eternity. Heaven is a place where we have a new body that's most what it was always meant to be. It's something that is recognizable but not. We recognize people not just by their bodies but by their personality and their mannerisms and lots of things, actually. So I think that's all wrapped up in that. It's a place of newness, us being as we are most supposed to be. So there's just some quick thoughts there feeding into heaven, what it'd be like, something definitely to look forward to. If you want to do some more reading around the subject, a great book to read is Surprised by Hope, which is written by Tom Wright, that he explores what happens to us when we die. Where do we go straight away? Where do we ultimately go to, and what is that like, you know, into the further future? There's lots of thoughts around that, and what heaven is like. So do have a look at that. Surprised by Hope by Tom Wright. There's some good thoughts there. Now, what we are going to do is move to a couple of songs, so a time of worship together, that encapsulate, again, pick up on this sense of what heaven is like. The first one very much feeds into our stumbling, grasping language when we try and communicate and picture what heaven is actually like. And it's called I Can Only Imagine. It's our first song.
When that day comes, I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
I only can imagine, and that's what we are trying to do as we think about heaven. A difficult subject, but it is a mystery and something that we are called to use our imagination to try and engage with. Now Mike is going to introduce our last song. Mike, over to you.
So our final song gives, I think, a wonderful vision of heaven, taken from, again, from Revelation, this time Revelation 7, with all of us, and probably just a few others, standing before the throne of God, made perfect by Jesus, the Lamb of God, who will become our Shepherd King. And before we enjoy this beautiful and, I think, anointed song, let's just take a moment to pray through the chorus and join with John's vision of our eternal home. Hear heaven's voices sing. Their thunderous anthem rings through emerald courts and sapphire skies. Their praises rise. All glory, wisdom, power, strength, thanks, and honor be to God our King, who reigns on high forevermore. There is a higher throne.
World has known, where faithful ones from
So a final picture, which comes in a prayer written by John Donne in the 1600s, a prayer for us to finish with. Bring us, O Lord God, at our last awakening, into the house and gate of heaven. To enter into that gate and dwell in that house, where there shall be no darkness nor dazzling, but one equal light. No noise nor silence, but one equal music. No fears nor hopes, but one equal possession. No ends nor beginnings, but one equal eternity. In the habitations of thy majesty and glory, world without end. Amen.
Thank you, Sue, for that beautiful prayer. And thank you for joining us tonight. I hope we excited you about heaven and perhaps touched your imagination and stirred you. I'm excited about heaven. One of the reasons I'm a Christian is I'm looking forward to going there and living as I've always meant to live. And I hope all of you get glimpses of heaven on earth. Sometimes we do, and it just stirs our hearts and minds, and it's an amazingly powerful thing. So I hope we did a bit of that with you tonight. Do join us again on the 25th of April when we are doing this again. And the next and the subject for that one will be why worship. Why do we worship God? I remember someone saying to me that they weren't a Christian because if God was a God who needed us to completely be bigging him up all the time and always worshiping him, what kind of God is that? So why do we worship? What is all that about? And then the next one is on the 23rd of May, which is Pentecost, and we're looking at the Holy Spirit. So if you have any questions or thoughts or anything you feel you can contribute to those, do be in contact and do please join us. Thank you for being with us this evening. God bless and goodbye.